שלום לכולם. Good afternoon. I am Shimon Schiffer, a journalist with the Ediot Achronot. Our topic will be about Israel and America, the strategic dimension. I hope that we'll succeed to entertain you, because the best thing to do now is to take a nap, but we'll try.
Keep you awake.
I'm very pleased to introduce Senator Mark Kirk from Illinois, a Republican. Shortly, if I would have to present him an award, I would say that he should get the award of the true friend of Israel. Most of the issues that he was involved with about Israel helped all the bloody Israelis to sleep better. I can't reveal now state secrets, but I can assure you that he's the one that helped us. And one day when you'll be in the Negev, ask some questions, and maybe you'll get answer about a senator, about a true friend that in his Senate office and within his other activities, he helped us from the bottom of his heart. I'd like to say a few words about Major General retired Amos Gilad, one of the best brains that we produced here, and his involvement almost in every sensitive issue that relates to our security, about our relations with this wild neighborhood, with the other countries around us, Egypt, Jordan, other countries, and of course, with America. So there is no better moment to speak about the strategic dimension of our relations with America than today, the day after the speech given by the American president about Iran. And my first question to the senator, there is a famous saying between the Jewish people. It presents worriness. What will happen? What will happen now? Senator, what will happen now after the speech by the president? We should be worried, or how we should behave? Please.
Quickly, I'll say that Iran has the wrong idea that they can force the entire world to come to their terms. And when you have a GDP that's only equal to a GDP of the state of Virginia, you cannot turn the whole world. They're just not that important anymore. And these days, with the Trump energy policy bringing fracking on board, and the United States becoming such a large oil producer, oil is just less and less important. I would say with such a small GDP, Iran has a tough time mattering. But that they might think that nuclear weapons is the only way to matter. To get the Europeans to break the US embargo, the thing I want to point out that the US economy is growing very fast now, and the Iranian economy is shrinking. Been shrinking since 2012. With two-thirds of Iranians being young, 74 million people are young people. And they're, as we know, all young people addicted to the internet. The internet has a basic set of values of openness, modernism. Iran represents the 7th century. Iran represents the 7th century fighting the 21st century. In that battle, it's no doubt that the 21st century will win. over the 7th century.
From your point of view,
the coffee.
I can think that the president made the right decision, isn't it?
He did make the right decision. And by being tough on Iran, he may reap the benefit in Korea, because the North Koreans saw the magnificent airstrike on Syria. I will say that people should know just how massive that airstrike was. 17 aircraft over the Mediterranean, all stationed like a set of gas stations all the way to Syria. That was quite an aerial ballet that he put on of combat power. The United States pulled off a massive airstrike, and it does appear that the Syrians only knew when they were under attack when the bombs started exploding.
General, now let's get to the Israeli perspective. In a poor article that I published this morning, I raised the question that, okay, Trump did this and that, but the Israelis, maybe they will pay the price for his decision. And we are talking about two decisions or even declarations by Trump, the declaration about Iran and the decision to move the American embassy to Jerusalem. Do you think that we'll have to pay the real price, maybe that will endanger our security?
First, I would like to salute Senator Mark Kirk. I mean, I did have the privilege to know him. He's so qualitative, and his friendship to Israel is unbelievable. He, for example, took personal decision to give Israel capabilities of one of the most sensitive radars in US, that we are not allowed as Israelis even to touch it. And he insisted it would come to Israel. But it cost, it's very cheap, it's $300 million. So the American Armed Forces got order to redeploy from Los Angeles, that's power of one senator that at that time was congressman, to move, to relocate the radar that cost $300 million to the Negev. It's so sensitive, it guarded only by American soldiers. Israelis with the highest classification like me cannot enter it. And this radar is so smart that it can save us a lot of trouble that I save from you now.
You revealed the real, a real top secret story. But let's get back to the to my question about the price.
Yeah, okay. About Iran, about Trump's decision. Of course, it's very moving to have such speech about Jerusalem, about Iran. The problem is Iran, they are determined to destroy Israel. It's true, by the way. It's not propaganda. And they are determined to build the capabilities gradually. And I have mentioned it in the morning. Hezbollah Stam, 130,000 rockets, missiles that are accurate. At the end of the day, nuclear. Now, the Iranians are not impressed by declarations, and the United States of America led drastic, frightening sanctions on Iran. They were very close to collapse, and then President Obama has decided to save them with terrible agreement. Now, the question out, here is my answer. President Trump, let's say, he's not successful in leading the whole world about sanctions on Iran. So United States is isolated. Secondly, if he changes agreement that the Iranians haven't violated, there is a question about agreements at all, but that's not the issue now because we don't have time. I'm concerned that the Iranian, as I know, that the Iranians will follow the agreement while pretending they are respecting it, in order to get the support of Russia, China, Germany, France, and the title will be new agreement. Which new agreement? The Iranians will not sign it. So it means that in due time that they will choose, we might find ourselves isolated with the United States vis-a-vis the Iranian efforts. It's true their economy is shrinking. However, the evil, the product, the GDP of the evil is widening. And they are so vicious and evil, and they are building now empire. And I give you the last example because I don't want to talk too much. In Syria, the president has said, I don't want to be there. So who is there? Iran. And we are very close to confrontation with them in Syria, and Russia, and Iran. And there is alliance against Israel. United States is not there. So I am less impressed by rhetoric, and I'm more impressed by performance. United States is so big, it can cope with any threat. Israel, against the image, together with India, we do have a general from India, we are 1.3 billion people. The internal division is secret. So we need to take it in a realistic way. About the embassy, as Israeli citizen, it's moving. However, what about our prospects that I think very important, even to keep our relationship with the Arabs, with the Palestinians? It seems to me they are getting more and more desperate. And from Israel's point of view, and I used to deal with them significant part of my life in many jobs, I'm very worried that they are losing the moderate forces, and it gives room to the toughest ones.
There is a piece of advice that I used to give to my friends. Never raise an assessment on events that will happen a week from now, because everyone will remember how idiot you are. Always try to give assessments about 10 years from now. But again, and I really like you, Amos, you didn't answer my question. We are on an eve of a war with Iran.
No, that you didn't ask me, but I give you the answer. No.
No, I ask you about the price.
No, the price is economic, GDP. I give you the answer. There are two terms in the intelligence language: build up of capabilities and using the capabilities. The Iranians are determined to build up hostile capabilities in Lebanon, in Syria, in Iran, and so on, based on the ideology, as I've mentioned. In order to get it, they don't want to be in confrontation with Israel now. So even the attacks they are planning and keep declaring, we will take revenge in Syria, they mean two impressive retaliation, and then to avoid full-scale confrontation. So my conclusion is we are not going to face war against the mood. We are in process of confrontation with Iran, and that's different.
Thank you. Senator, what's your expectation from the Israeli side, how we can contribute to this special relationship with America? What do you expect from us?
I think the big thing is right now, for the president, when he committed the U.S. forces to hitting the Syrian targets, political support is key. And for the president, he values loyalty above almost everything. And that support will be politically repaid very well if Israel supports things like the strike that's done by the United States.
When did you started to understand your friendship with Israel? Tell us something about the beginning.
For me, the beginning was, I when I first came to, I came on Project Interchange trip for congressional staffers. I had unfortunately missed my flight, so I had to go to the Tel Aviv bus station. And they said, in the chaos of that bus station, here I was, an American congregational church guy with no Hebrew whatsoever, and some Russian Jews put me on a cheroot. I remember there were military maneuvers going on or something. The whole bus seemed to be full of soldiers, and everybody had put their duffel bag in the aisle of the bus. I laid down on the it was almost better than first class on the duffel bags. And turned to the people next to me, and I said, "Hi, I'm Mark Kirk from Chicago." And I said, "Do you guys speak English?" They said, "No, solamente español." I said, "Pues, you know, estudié en México un año. I studied in Mexico one year." And they said, "Ah, somos judeos de Jews from Argentina." Only Israel could that happen. Where we have the conversation with random people on a bus in another language, so multicultural. And for me, I went to Kibbutz Ginosar. And that, I think, was helped by Germany after the war for obvious reasons. And to see that whole place resurrecting from the ashes of the Holocaust, it was, Israel for me was always a morality test. If it was always a test for how well we, I would say this, I constantly talk to American Jewish audiences. I say, you are so very lucky to be an American Jew. At this time, you have access to congressmen and senators, and you can correct the mistakes of the 1930s by making sure we always remember. And, you know, to take the lessons of our grandparents and all those years of Zionism and have the opportunity of informed action to make sure that you can make a real difference. We always know with Israeli society so well connected to the internet, if there are crimes against Jews, we will never hear silence. The Jews everywhere are safer because of the state of Israel. And it's always a morality test on us if we can keep the strong state of Israel here, especially for weapons of mass destruction. And I gotta say that Prime Minister, as a Navy intel officer, seeing that briefing by the Prime Minister of Israel, so specific on the details, it was devastating to the case of Iran. And that was the perfect case that needed to be right before the president's decision. He played it perfectly.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Amos, but when you have to explain to a newcomer from America what could be our contribution to this alliance with America?
Thanks God we do have. Give you one example. Our capabilities of intelligence are really appreciated, not as politeness. In English you have politeness that means nothing. Very interesting, it means bullshit and so on. This cooperation we do have with the United States, with agencies like NSA, CIA, DIA, it's real concrete contribution to the national security of US. I'm not empowered to say it, but I do have the perspective to say it. And it's developing dramatically from year to year. It's unbelievable. Even today, I compare it to the period I've served in our intelligence for a long time, it's unbelievable. Secondly, we are relying on the IDF. We are the cheapest carrier of the United States from their point of view.
That's right.
They don't need to send soldiers besides the Marines who are protecting the embassy and the others who are protecting what Mark Kirk, a senator, has given us. Besides that, we are relying on our capabilities. Thirdly, take the North Korean project. United States reached agreement with North Korea and others to dismantle it. It was dismantled. They shut down the project in Yongbyon. And then they built secretly very dangerous one that could be taken over by Daesh. Can you imagine the leader of Daesh declaring, I'm going to explode the Middle East? And we destroyed it. Now, not allegedly, but really. I think there are more, and the last, we are part of stability based on our relationship with the Arabs. For US, it's a great asset.
Yes. I'd like to ask you, Senator, before we'll conclude, two presidents. President Trump represents a way of thinking, and we saw it last night, very tough, very direct toward Iran. Before Trump, we had 8 years of Barack Obama that legitimately he does represent a way of thinking that America should be more cautious and should try to find an alliance with other countries. Why, from your point of view, as a Republican, as someone from Illinois, Barack Obama failed in such a way?
There's one thing I'd like to share, a story with, I'd like to share with you, the value of Israel to the United States. It relates to our security as a democracy, an open society under terror threat. When September 11th happened, I called David Ivry up and said, could you please help us think through all the issues of airport security? I remember David said, Mark, El Al has about 40 flights a day. You have 4,000 flights a day. The scale of the U.S. situation is so much larger. I don't know what we can do for you in Israel. And when he flew a team over to meet with our House Subcommittee on Aviation to write the Transportation Security Act, I say this story with some tongue-in-cheek, because if you travel in the U.S., you really don't like the TSA. I don't want people to blame their bad experience with TSA on Israel at all. We designed the entire TSA based off an Israeli model. So I have told American audiences, you know, when you fly from Chicago to Des Moines and go through TSA security, you are under some Israeli protection because the Israelis helped design the whole system. And that's a good thing. So we can be a democracy dealing with terror as an open society because of our relationship with Israel.
So I'd like to thank you both. And I'd like to say that most of the Israelis, they are not aware of this basic fact that they can sleep well because of guys like Senator Mark Kirk. And a few others. I had the opportunity for many years to follow our friends in America. And from time to time, we forget to say the very basic word, thank you. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you very much.
And at the same time, thank you, General. But it's we need a different time to talk about your contribution. Litraot.